Thank you so much, and thank all of you for joining us on a Saturday, on a weekend, and for being that interested in the work that I do. I'm going to share my screen. And one of the things that I want to point out is I'm a, by trade, I am a forensic DNA analyst. And I, as my career has progressed, I started wanting to work on more and more challenging samples. DNA technology is so good that a lot of the current casework samples, like, you know, all the cases that you see on TV about, you know, recent homicides, sexual assaults, et cetera, if you get to the samples relatively quickly, after the crime has occurred, our modern DNA technology is very, very good at detecting the profiles of the unknown people that deposited those blood, saliva, semen samples, etc. What I wanted to explore, and this is kind of the direction that my career took, is what are the limits of modern DNA technology? And so as I started exploring this, I started getting contacted by historical societies and archaeological teams all over the US who had human skeletal remains that they had recovered and wanted to know if I could get DNA profiles from them. So I'm gonna show you kind of a small portfolio of some of the historical and archaeological human skeletal remains that I've performed DNA testing on, just to kind of show you how good our modern DNA technology is and what we can do with historical and archaeological cases. And you know, a lot of times people think historical and archaeological cases aren't important, but I'd just like to point out that these are really the coldest of cold cases. You know, that we have this tendency in forensic casework to only want to work a case that is current and probative, meaning the persons or person who were involved in, say, murdering someone are still alive, and if we find out who they are, we could convict them and send them to prison. But I like to say, and I'm a big history buff, that just because skeletal remains that recover from historical and archaeological cases are from sometimes hundreds to thousands of years ago, these are still human beings. These were still people, and I still find it fascinating to investigate who they are. So my contact information is on the left-hand side of the screen, and I believe we're taping this so you can refer back to this as we move forward. So the first case I want to talk to you about is the LaBelle shipwreck. And many of you probably remember from elementary school or grade school studying about the French explorer La Salle, and or Sieur de La Salle is how he's referred to a lot of times in the literature. And he was a 17th century French explorer who kept sailing over here to the New World to help establish French colonies on behalf of King Louis, and also to kind of traverse the Mississippi River. He was trying to find where the Mississippi River dumped into the Gulf of Mexico. So this is a reconstruction of the LaBelle, which was the name of the ship that sank in 1686. And this is one of the skulls that was recovered and excavated from that shipwreck. So I'm going to give you some background on La Salle, and then I'm going to show you a part of this entire case that to me was absolutely fascinating. Even though I'm not an archaeologist, I got to be involved in some of this other stuff that was really, really cool from a scientific perspective. So these are sketches of La Salle. And again, he was a 17th century French explorer. He's best known for exploring the Great Lakes, the Mississippi River, and the Gulf of Mexico. So La Salle, prior to this particular journey or this particular expedition that I'm going to talk to you about, he had been on several other expeditions to the New World. And in the early to mid 1680s, he went back to France and told King Louis that he had traversed the entire length of the almost the entire length of the Mississippi River as it runs through the U.S., and he needed more ships and supplies to go back to find out where the Mississippi River ends. In other words, where the Mississippi River dumps into the Gulf of Mexico. So to kind of give you perspective on how long this journey was and how fascinating it is that we were able to recover these remains from a bay off the coast of Texas. If you look on this map, on July 24, 1684, La Salle set sail for the New World from France on four different ships. And in total, there were about 400 people on these ships. And of course, this was a multiple month journey. When I think about these types of journeys, they're so fascinating to me because this is the 1700s. And of course, they didn't have, you know, buffets and air conditioning and heat and everything on these ships. This was just a basic wooden ship that they set sail from France to come over to the New World on. And that's just really fascinating to me. It shows you how good we have it nowadays in terms of modern comforts. But these are the names of the four ships. Of course, the La Belle shipwreck is the one that I'm focused on, but you'll see they departed France in July. In September, one of those ships was seized by pirates. So they lost that ship from the expedition. And in February 1685 was when the La Belle ship reached the Texas coast. And the La Belle was the main ship. It was the ship that the French explorer La Salle was on himself. And so you'll see this was a 7,600 mile journey all the way to the coast of Texas here. And they ended up, this is kind of a zoomed in map of the coast of Texas, the eastern coast of Texas or the Gulf Coast. Oops, sorry. This is the Matagorda Bay here. So remember they arrived in the New World off the coast of Texas in February, which is winter time. And even though it doesn't get as cold down in Texas as it does here in Connecticut in the greater New York area, it's still quite cold and the seas, the ocean can be pretty rough. So what the La Belle did, they were trying to find along this Texas coast where the Mississippi River dumped into the Gulf of Mexico. And they had not found that location yet, but the seas were getting very rough, the waters were getting very rough, so they were seeking shelter from the storms. So they actually tried to sail into this little narrow pass here. There's a peninsula that shields this bay from a lot of the rough water during storms. So they were trying to enter and navigate into this bay just for safety. And also so they could anchor in the bay and then take small rowboats to shore and explore the shoreline and figure out whether they needed to go northeast, south, or west to find where the Mississippi River was. So one of those ships sank trying to enter the bay because it was a very narrow pass. And that was unfortunate because that ship had a lot of their supplies on it. Because the other goal of this expedition, other than to discover where the Gulf of Mexico dumps, or where the Mississippi River dumps into the Gulf of Mexico, the other goal was to set up a French colony along the shoreline. And of course they were going to name it Fort St. Louis after King Louis. So they brought a bunch of supplies to set up this French colony, and one of their ships, the ship of the four ships that had the vast majority of supplies, sank trying to enter that bay. the LaBelle in January 1686 anchored right here. I'm hoping you guys can see my arrow in the Matagorda Bay. And at that point, they were just anchored there and they were exploring the shoreline. And a big storm came while they were anchored in the bay and it dragged the ship backwards. And in February 1686, the ship sank right here in the Matagorda Bay. The shipwreck was discovered in 1996, and it took about 10 years to excavate everything that was in that shipwreck. And again, this was the LaBelle, which was LaSalle's main ship. They recovered 1.6 million artifacts from the shipwreck and two sets of human skeletal remains. And those are the two sets of human skeletal remains that I worked on, that I was asked to perform DNA testing on. If any of you, just to also give you perspective, if you look at the state of Texas map here, that red dot that I'm circling right here, that's about where the Matagorda Bay is. So it's on the Gulf Coast of Texas. There have been several books that are written about this expedition, as well as about the search for the shipwreck, the discovery of the shipwreck, and how it was ultimately recovered and excavated from the middle of the bay. This is a screenshot of one of the books that's been written by Texas Historical Commission, particularly their archaeological team. And then, of course, this is another book, the LaBelle, the ship that changed history. This is actually a photograph that they took of what was remaining of LaBelle on the bottom of the ocean in the Matagorda Bay off the coast of Texas. So I mentioned at the beginning of the presentation that even though I'm a DNA expert and not an archaeologist, I often work alongside archaeologists and anthropologists, and it's one of the things that I think is most fascinating. I think I'll be a, I must have been an anthropologist or an archaeologist in a past life. But let me explain to you how they excavated this shipwreck out of the middle of the bay. So they built what's called a cofferdam, which is a temporary metal wall, basically, that they built around the shipwreck. And then they pumped all the water out, and they essentially did a dry excavation of a shipwreck in the middle of the Matagorda Bay in the Gulf of Mexico. And these are actual photos. So they have boats. This is the one of the Texas Historical Commission scientist boats that transported the scientists out to the cofferdam daily so they could excavate the shipwreck. And they, just to give you perspective of how big this was, you can see this machinery here. They built a platform around the cofferdam so that as they were pulling artifacts out of the shipwreck, they could dry them out in the sun, label them, tag them, and get them prepared for transport back to the shoreline. My slide forwarding was not working. These are some actual photos also of the cofferdam excavation of the shipwreck. If you look at the photo on the left, you can see that they are in the middle of the bay here, and there's one of their boats. And of course, they've pumped the water out of the cofferdam wall that they built around the shipwreck. And they've got scaffolding here that they were able to get down. The archaeologists were able to get down in there and excavate the shipwreck layer by layer. A lot of it was embedded in the sand on the ocean floor. So that's why it took literally about almost 10 years to get everything out of this shipwreck. It was a very expensive, very time and labor intensive endeavor. But as you can see here, these were those old wooden expedition ships that had the really tall masts and sails on them. And so a lot of that stuff had rotted and collapsed. And so the majority of what was remaining was the bottom or the hull and the bow of the ship. So I'm going to touch on briefly some of the DNA work that I did on the two adult male skeletons. that were recovered from the shipwreck. If any of you want to read more detail about that, I did publish the DNA work that I did on these skeletons. But one thing I want to say is there were obviously more than two individuals on this ship. So back in those days when they were doing these explorations and expeditions, they kept diaries and ship logs. And we know that there were approximately 30 individuals on this ship. And we don't know which of the two of the 30 that were on the ship log, on the official diary accounts. We don't know which two we have. So that was part of the request for DNA testing on these two sets of skeletal remains. We know for sure that we don't have the remains of LaSalle, because we know from the historical record that LaSalle was murdered by his own men. His own men mutinied and killed him somewhere in this, what is now the state of Texas, and LaSalle's remains have never been found. So we know we don't have him, but we don't know which two of the 30 individuals on the LaBelle we found. So here's another screenshot of what's called the ISHI report. ISHI stands for the International Symposium for Human Identification, and they profiled this case just last month. This was a November 2020 article about the DNA work that I did on this case, and I gave you the link at the bottom that you can freely access this if you want to read more in detail. So again, we discovered two adult male skeletons, and the archaeological team named them individual one and individual two. So I'm not going to go through this in hyper detail, but individual one was a partial human skeleton, so we didn't find the whole thing. You know, imagine these are remains that have been submerged in a shipwreck that sank in 1686. So there's a lot of water movement and marine wildlife and stuff that likely contributed to the other individuals not being recovered from the shipwreck. We had an anthropologist analyze these remains, and they estimated he was between 20 and 40 years old, and you might say that's a pretty broad range. That estimate is so broad because it was a partial skeleton. The more complete the skeleton is, the more accurate the age estimation is. And what's interesting about this is, based on measurements of some of the long bones that were present in the partial skeleton, they estimated that this individual was about 5 feet 11 inches tall, which is very tall for Europeans of that time period. So they presumed him to be male because of the fact that he was so tall. But that was something they noted from the beginning, and I'm telling you this because the DNA solved this for us. But, you know, from the beginning, they were like, whoa, he's really tall for someone of European ancestry. This is the actual right fibula that we received in the laboratory for DNA testing. They had previously done some isotope testing on this individual's bones, which was separate from the DNA testing, because they wanted to try to assess if this individual was of European descent or maybe a local Native American, which again, the DNA answered this question for us. But let me remind you, this is a ship that sailed over to the New World from France. So we made some presumptions that everybody that had sank with that shipwreck was French. And that's not what we found when we did the DNA testing, which was quite interesting. I just wanted to show you a little bit of how we get DNA from skeletal remains. So it is a destructive process. We do have to take a bone saw, an autopsy saw basically, and take small cuttings from the shaft of the bone. And then we use a basic Dremel tool. I'm sure some of you, if any of you do woodwork or craft work, you've probably worked with an electric Dremel with sanding stones or grinding stones. We sand off the surface of the bone, the outer surface and the inner surface, to get rid of anything that's been caked on there from the environment. And then ultimately what we do is we pulverize those bone cuttings into a fine powder. We super freeze the bone sections using liquid nitrogen, and then we pulverize them into powder. Mix that bone powder with a bunch of chemicals to try to extract the DNA. And then we try to profile the DNA that's in those remains. So I know this might look like Swahili to some of you, but one of the things that so I'll just kind of summarize it. One of the things that I wanted to do with this individual, because we thought he was a male based on the above average height that was determined by examining his skeleton, is I wanted to do Y chromosome DNA testing. So if you remember, females have two X chromosomes and males have one X chromosome and one Y chromosome. So typically what we do is we take multiple different cuttings from the bone and we powderize it, extract the DNA, and then profile whatever part of the DNA we're looking at. In this case, it was Y chromosome DNA. And we're hoping that the DNA's intact enough, it's not so degraded, that we can detect enough partial DNA profiles to piece together into one complete full DNA profile. So that's why you're seeing here the fibula. I had four different cuttings from the fibula that I started testing first for the Y chromosome DNA profile. And when we do DNA testing on skeletal remains, one of the things we have to do at the very end after we get the DNA profile is prove that the DNA profile that we obtained came from the skeletal remains and not from one of the male archaeologists or one of the male anthropologists that physically handled the remains prior to submission for DNA testing. So the good thing about all of these remains that I'm going to talk to you about today is that I'm female, and I did 100% of the DNA testing and processing of these remains, and I'm a female, so I have two X chromosomes, so this Y chromosome profile could not have come from me, meaning I didn't contaminate these remains. But there were three male archaeologists that were involved in that extensive 10-year-long cofferdam excavation of the shipwreck and of the remains. And so I asked them to give me just basic cheek swab samples so that I could extract their DNA and prove that the DNA profile that I obtained in the laboratory came from the skeletal remains and it wasn't contamination from one of the male archaeologists. So as you can see, everything that's highlighted in yellow are basic points in the DNA that differ from the DNA profile that I recovered from the remains. So I was able to exclude the entire archaeological team as being the source of this DNA. So we knew we had this individual that sailed over from France, or that we thought sailed over from France in the late 1600s, we had his Y chromosome DNA profile. This was probably a 4 or 5 year project for me. It was a case that I worked on for several years. And so as new testing came out, I applied more and more advanced testing to these remains. And of course, these are just some more Y chromosome results that I got with a new and improved Y chromosome testing kit. And I got a lot more data, obviously. And then what you can do when you get a Y chromosome profile from skeletal remains is, other than match it directly to someone that's living, like a living descendant, is you can take that Y chromosome DNA profile and you can upload it into a program that's called Y Haplogroup Predictor. This is a freely accessible online tool for those of you that are doing maybe your own genealogy and ancestry studies on your own. You can take an unknown DNA profile, a Y DNA profile from skeletal remains, upload it into the system, and it will predict for you, based on the Y chromosome DNA, what is the ancestry or biogeographic race or ethnicity of these unknown skeletal remains. And this was quite interesting because remember this ship came over here from France. And so we assumed that this individual was of European Caucasian descent. We got, with the Y-DNA profile, we got haplogroup Q with 100% probability. And haplogroup Q is the primary Y-DNA haplogroup for Native Americans. So at this point, I thought, there's no way, something's going on here. This is a French ship that sailed over here from France, subsidized and paid for by King Louis. How did we get a Native American skeletal remains recovered from the shipwreck? So this was quite surprising to all of us that worked on this case. So I started doing some more research on what is this Y-DNA haplogroup Q, and it is true that the vast majority of individuals that have Y chromosome haplogroup Q are Native American, but there is a small pocket of individuals in the Rhone Alps region of France, and these are obviously European Caucasian descent individuals in France that do have this haplogroup Q. It's not the predominant or most common Y-DNA haplogroup in France, but there are a pocket of males in France that have this particular haplogroup. So I was convinced at that point that that's what it was. Yes, we know this guy is haplogroup Q, but he has to be a male from this Rhone Alps region of France, because how else would you explain a Native American individual being at the bottom of the ocean in a shipwreck that was funded by King Louis in France and that originated in France? And then, of course, I did, you know, those of you that are interested in forensic genealogy, I looked around for some more information on haplogroup Q and found several websites or genealogy sites that do talk about haplogroup Q males being from the Rhone Alps region of France. So then I did some, I wasn't convinced then, you know, I was like, what is going on with this haplogroup Q? So then what I did is I tested an entirely separate region of the DNA and different types of markers than the Y chromosome markers. And these markers are called ancestry informative SNPs, or single nucleotide polymorphisms. So it's like testing another section of the DNA to gain more information about this unknown individual. And I tested this individual's ancestry informative SNPs to figure out, did he have the Y chromosome haplogroup Q because he's from the Rhone Alps region of France? Or did he have the Y chromosome haplogroup Q because he's Native American? So I needed other information from his DNA to refute or confirm that assessment. So I tested the SNPs, and actually here at Yale University here in Connecticut, there is a professor named Dr. Ken Kidd, K-I-D-D, and he maintains a SNP DNA marker database that contains the SNP marker profiles for 164 different reference populations, so from different ethnic groups from all around the world. And what you do is you do the DNA testing in the lab of these ancestry informative SNP markers, and then you can upload your DNA testing results into this database, and it will compare the unknown SNP DNA profile from skeletal remains to these 164 reference populations. And then it kind of spits out to you the most probable population or ethnic group that this unknown skeleton belongs to. And again, I thought we had an individual that was from the Rhone Alps region of France because it was a French ship and a French shipwreck, a French expedition. So as you can see here, actually what you get from the data analysis is it ranks the most probable ethnic or racial group the most probable population that those unknown skeletal remains belong to, from most likely to least likely. And it will list all 164 reference populations, but I just took a screenshot of the top 10 here to show you. So this, by looking at a totally different set of DNA markers, now we're seeing that the 10 most probable ethnic groups or racial groups that this individual belonged to, doesn't matter which of these 10 you look at, they're Native American. So we started, we were really confused at that point because we thought, how is it possible that there's a Native American sunk in the bottom of the ocean in a French ship? And we have two possible explanations for this. First, we had the historians and the genealogists go and research that the origins of this expedition and who, remember I told you there were approximately 400 people total that sailed over here on these four ships, and that that was not LaSalle's first expedition. So it turns out on some previous expeditions, LaSalle had befriended some local Native Americans, and he had actually brought them on as part of his team to help him scout the area and just for protection and making connections with local Native Americans. So this could have been a Native American that was now part of LaSalle's expedition, because we do have the ship logs and the diary accounts. Because, by the way, a bunch of people that were on this expedition survived the shipwreck, so they didn't all perish in the shipwreck. And some of them eventually made it back to France, and they had those diary accounts and those historical records with them. So we do know that there were a couple of Native Americans on this expedition. There were guides for LaSalle. Also, this bay is relatively shallow, and the Native Americans along the shoreline in the Gulf of Mexico, they knew when the Europeans sailed over here, they were coming with lots of riches. They were coming with lots of supplies because their goal was to take over land in this area and establish French colonies, to claim land on behalf of France. So it's possible, because this bay was relatively shallow, it's possible that there were some Native Americans in this area that were looting the shipwreck. And the reason we say that is because, and that we favor that theory, because this set of skeletal remains was found in the cargo area of the ship. So he was found alongside a lot of the crates that had supplies and weapons that were brought over here from Europe. So that was a surprise. And then I further confirmed that Native American ancestry prediction by looking at the other type of DNA that's in our cells. So we have nuclear DNA in our cells and mitochondrial DNA. And Y chromosome DNA will tell you what the paternal lineage of a set of skeletal remains is, what is their paternal or male lineage. The mitochondrial DNA will tell you what an unidentified set of skeletal remains maternal lineage is, so what their lineage is on the female side of the family. And so I did mitochondrial DNA sequencing, and I know this, again, might look like Swahili, but I was able to determine, I was able to recover enough data to determine the mitochondrial DNA haplogroup and its haplogroup C1b, which essentially is the primary mitochondrial haplogroup of Native American ancestry. So we have multiple different types of DNA markers that we can test in unidentified skeletal remains to help predict someone's ancestry or ethnicity. Now, ultimately, we're going to take this DNA data, and we have a group of genealogists and historians that are trying to track down living family members or living descendants of all 30 individuals who were on the ship log for the LaBelle, so that we can get cheek swab samples from them and try to identify which two individuals we have of the 30 who were on that ship. another type of marker that we can, or set of markers that we can test for in skeletal remains. Since remains are skeletonized and we can't see what that person looked like when they were living, we can test certain regions of the DNA to predict with relatively high degree of accuracy what that person looked like when they were alive. What was their eye color and hair color? And so I tested that set of markers. And again, you can see here this individual with about a 67% accuracy. There's a 67% probability that this individual had black hair and 99 plus percent chance that he had brown eyes. And that's very consistent with the Native American ancestry prediction. So that, you know, that's kind of a snapshot. This is it's a lot more detailed than that. There's a lot more that went into that, but I'm kind of showing you the end result of all the DNA work that was done on that set of skeletal remains. But let's talk about individual two, because I told you individual one was a partial skeletal remain. Individual two was an almost complete skeleton. And this is an actual photo of the way the skeleton was found in the shipwreck. So he's laying on top of coiled up anchor rope. And there was a pewter cup lying next to the set of skeletal remains with the name C. Barange engraved on it. So we think that this individual might be C. Barange. It's a French name, so that's, you know, fits with the origins of this expedition. But we're not presuming that. We never presume that in science because, again, this ship sank in 1686 and wasn't discovered until 1996. So there's a lot of movement in water and shifting of things in this shipwreck due to being sunk in the bay. So this cup could be lying next to him because it's his cup and that's who he is, or it could have floated over from another area of the ship. This adult male was analyzed by a forensic anthropologist. They estimated he's between 5'4" and 5'6", which is more consistent with the average heights of Europeans during that time period. And the age estimation is the age range estimation is a lot narrower for this individual because we had a virtually complete skeleton. And remember I said that age estimation is much more accurate the more bones you have to look at. So he was estimated to be in his mid-30s to early 40s when he died. And this is a replica, a casting of his skull. That's why it looks so clean, because it's not the original skull. We had a forensic artist in Michigan do a skull reconstruction to try to find out what this man looked like when he was living. And this is his rendition of the skull reconstruction. This was the pewter cup that was recovered from the shipwreck, and it was laying alongside his skeleton as it was coiled up on the anchor rope. And if you look closely here where the arrow is, you can see the name C. Barange engraved on that cup. DNA testing for this individual, these are actual photos that I took of the bones that I did DNA work on. I had a rib and a couple of teeth that we started working with. Again, I told you that to get DNA from bones is a destructive process, so we have to take cuttings from the bone and pulverize them into a powder to mix with chemicals and extract the DNA. Here's some images of the teeth that I had to work with. And I mentioned earlier, I'm showing you this slide because I mentioned earlier that we pulverize the bone, we submerge the bone in liquid nitrogen and we hyperfreeze it, and then we pulverize it into a fine powder. It actually comes out the consistency of baby powder. It's a very fine powder that then we mix in a tube with DNA extraction chemicals to get the DNA out of the cells that are in the bone. Like the previous individual, this set of skeletal remains was a male, so I some DNA testing on him, and of course everything that's in yellow shows you differences between the Y chromosome DNA profile from the skeletal remains and the Y DNA profiles from the males in the archaeological team. So we know we don't have contamination here. We have the actual DNA profile that came from the rib and from the teeth. And then just like with the first individual I showed you, I tested a whole different set of DNA markers for this individual, the ancestry informative SNPs, and compared it against that reference database of 164 populations from around the world. And these are the top 10 most probable populations that that unidentified male belongs to. And these are the top one is most likely population. The bottom one is least likely, at least for the top 10. So you can see he's definitely European. So we ended up having one European male, one Native American male that were recovered from that shipwreck. And we're currently in the process of, again, working with historians and genealogists to try to match these DNA profiles to living descendants of the 30 people that were aboard the ship, again, to figure out which of the two individuals do we have. To further confirm the Y chromosome ancestry prediction, I also, again, tested the mitochondrial DNA, determined it was haplogroup H1, which also is a very common mitochondrial DNA haplogroup in Europe. So all of the different sets of markers that I tested on each of these sets of remains, what those sets of markers were telling me were consistent with each other. So we typically do that with skeletal remains as we look at several different groups of markers so that we can further reinforce our predictions about who this individual was. I wanted to show you the latest, so this is kind of an ongoing project, but the latest reconstruction of individual two. We didn't have individual number one's skull. It was only a partial skeleton, so we weren't able to use forensic art and sculpting to try to find out what this individual looked like. But for individual two, we had his skull. Again, here's a casting or a replica of the skull, and this is what the forensic sculptor put together with clay by building it with along with tissue depth pegs on the skull and clay. This was obviously what it looked like before he added the color. And this was just to show you where our current technology is taking us to. On the left-hand side of the screen, this was the clay reconstruction on the skull that was performed by a forensic artist in Michigan several years ago, like back in 2014 is when this reconstruction was done. On the right here, I've recently started working with a man named Daniel Bosshart, who actually he's a Hollywood guy. He works in graphic arts and computer-generated graphics for movies. He's done a lot of work for the Star Trek series. And he took this clay skull reconstruction that we did on the skull of individual two, and he converted it to a more lifelike image based on his computer graphic and art expertise. So you can see it really brings him to life a lot more than the clay reconstructions. And this on the right-hand side of the screen, this is a newer technology that's being applied to forensic casework, but it's much, much, much better and a much improved method over the clay reconstructions. And of course, in my mind, he would have looked a lot more disheveled than this because he was a 17th century explorer that sailed over here across the ocean for several months on a ship. But this is how we're kind of giving rehumanizing that skeleton that was found on the coiled up anchor rope to show you what he looks like, or what he did look like probably when he was alive. Another part of this project that's ongoing that perhaps I can come back another time and speak about, I mentioned that not everyone perished in that shipwreck. Some of them made it ashore, and they actually established a French colony along the Texas shoreline, and they named it Fort St. Louis after King Louis because King Louis funded this expedition. And, you know, I was just talking about the shipwreck of La Belle. This is the Matagorda Bay. The La Belle shipwreck was recovered here right next to this peninsula, and Fort St. Louis was established by the shipwreck survivors, and it's up here at the top left area of the map. And what happened is, so there was a lot of supplies on the shipwreck as well, and all of those supplies sank with the ship. And then remember at the beginning of this expedition, when they first reached the Texas coast, I told you that one of the ships sank when it was trying to enter this narrow pass into the bay for protection from the stormy seas. That ship had a lot of their supplies as well. So even the people that survived these shipwrecks and established this French colony, there were about 180 of them left. Remember, they started with about 400 when they left France. These colonists were not equipped to set up a colony without those supplies. They weren't very equipped to live off the land. So by January 1687, so within a year basically of the La Belle sinking, there were only about 50 colonists left at Fort St. Louis. They were dying from disease. Local Native Americans were killing them. They didn't have enough food because all their supplies sank. So what happened was La Salle, and this is an artist rendition. This historical site has also been excavated, and it's been kind of reconstructed based on what they found when they did the excavation. It was a small French colony. Again, there were less than 200 people there originally. By January 1687, La Salle took some of his most able-bodied men, and they left on foot from the colony to try to go and find help for the starving colonists that were remaining. And that December, the remaining colonists that they left behind were massacred by the local Karankawa Indians. So we have some excavated mass grave remains from that Karankawa Indian massacre as well. These are actual photos of some of the mass burials that are being excavated, and I'm doing DNA testing on these skeletal remains currently. And these are some of the artists, or I shouldn't say artists, these are the anthropologists' rendition of how the remains were commingled within the grave. This particular grave was a three-person burial, and so they excavate it layer by layer, and they note where each bone is in each layer. And so feature one, level one was the topmost layer, level two was the middle layer, so a little bit deeper than level one, and then the deepest most area in the mass grave was level three. And so this is what those of us as DNA analysts get in the lab, is we get a report of where all the bones were located in the commingled grave, and the anthropologist has usually assigned sample numbers to each bone, and then we get to sort through the bones and pick which bones look the best, both microscopically and macroscopically, and the bones that would be the best for DNA testing. So again, this is the part of the project that I'm still working on now. And then I'll take a few minutes just to go over one more case. It's not quite as long as that. And then I think I'm going to have to stop because we're running out of time. Another set of skeletal remains that I worked on a couple of years ago were the 120-year-old skeletal remains of a man named Ezekiel Harper. And this is an actual photo of him. He's a former Confederate guerrilla scout. So he was a soldier in the Civil War. And he actually survived the war, and he became a famous, wealthy country doctor. So the Civil War ended in 1865, and he was ultimately murdered in 1892, and he had become so wealthy as a doctor, he had amassed 4,000 acres of land in the state of West Virginia. And he never married, and he had a Native American maid that lived on his property. And that Native American maid had a little boy. And when he was murdered because he had no wife and kids, that Native American maid was sent away, and because she didn't have the means to take care of the little boy was sent to the county farm, which is essentially an orphanage. And that little boy grew up in the orphanage telling everyone that the famous Ezekiel Harper was his father. And everybody thought he was this crazy kid from the orphanage that wished he was related to someone as famous and wealthy as Ezekiel Harper. Long story short, that little boy grew up and had several children himself, and he told stories about Ezekiel Harper to his children, and his children and his grandchildren followed the development of the DNA field. And in 2011, they petitioned the state of West Virginia to exhume these skeletal remains for DNA testing to presume once and or to prove, I should say, once and for all, if indeed that little Native American boy that grew up in the orphanage, if he indeed was the son of Ezekiel Harper. And that was, for those of you that remember your history, that was very similar to the Thomas Jefferson case, where it was rumored that Thomas Jefferson had an affair with his African American maid and fathered a child, and that was proven definitively via DNA testing. This is very similar. It was purported that Ezekiel Harper fathered a child with his Native American maid, and that was kind of equally as salacious back in those times with all the racial prejudices that we had in this country. So I'm showing you a photo here to sum up this case. In this presentation, I mentioned at the beginning of this presentation that I wanted to show you how good our modern DNA technology is and how it can be applied to historical and archaeological cases. This is what Ezekiel Harper's remains looked like. This is what was left of him when they exhumed his remains in 2011. And, you know, you almost wouldn't even recognize that as a skeleton. It's so degraded. And of course, he was buried in a basic pine wooden coffin, which was normal during that time period. And the wood had rotted over time in the acidic soil in West Virginia. And so it had degraded the wood on the casket or the coffin. The coffin had collapsed down on top of him. And that's why his skull was crushed. And then this was what was left of the bones. So I ended up choosing the two lower leg bones, the tibiae, to test. And again, this is what they looked like when they arrived in the lab to me. And I got full DNA profiles from these bones. That's how good our technology is. So these are just images of what the bones look like when I received them for DNA testing. I mentioned to you earlier that we use a basic Dremel tool with the grinding stones on the end to sand off the top layer of the bone so that we're getting rid of all of the environmental contaminants before we take cuttings. Remember, I told you we have to take cuttings from the bone. It's a destructive process. We use a basic autopsy saw, and there's a photo here of a bone saw and an autopsy saw, and we take small cuttings from those tibiae, and then we pulverize those cuttings into a fine powder, mix the powder with a series of chemicals to extract the DNA. So long story short, this is the last slide that I'll go over because I know it's a Saturday and you guys don't want to hear me talk for 2 hours. This on the bottom here, we basically proved that yes, the little Native American boy that grew up in the orphanage was indeed the son of Ezekiel Harper, and we know that because we did Y chromosome DNA testing. So let me show you this family tree here. So Ezekiel Harper, again, was murdered and killed in 1892. He survived the Civil War, but he was later murdered during a home invasion because he was a wealthy individual. And it was rumored that he fathered this man named Earl J. Maxwell, with his Native American maid. And so remember that when Ezekiel was killed, Earl J. Maxwell was sent to the county farm, which is essentially an orphanage. And he grew up telling people that Ezekiel Harper was his father, and no one ever believed him. And thought it was the crazy kid at the orphanage that thought he was related to someone famous. So Earl J. Maxwell was already deceased at the time I was brought in on this case, and they did not want to exhume Earl J. Maxwell. So I had to get DNA reference samples from Earl Maxwell's grandsons. So Earl Maxwell himself had 7 children, and at the time of the DNA testing that I'd done in this case, which was like 2014, most of them were still living, but there were only 2 males. So there were 5 females and 2 males, and I needed Y chromosome DNA, and remember that females have 2 X chromosomes and males have 1 X chromosome and 1 Y chromosome. I needed the male lineage, the male family line DNA to prove this, because they didn't want us to exhume Earl Maxwell's remains. I had the skeletal remains of Ezekiel Harper, but not of Earl Maxwell. So one of Earl Maxwell's sons had passed away by the time I got involved in the case. The other one was still alive. But the Earl Maxwell's son that was still alive was in a nursing home and had dementia, so he could not give us consent to take a cheek swab or a DNA sample from him. So ultimately, we got cheek swabs or reference samples from Earl J. Maxwell's grandsons through his 2 sons, one of which was deceased and one of which was mentally and physically incapacitated and couldn't give us consent to get a sample. So again, the Y DNA profiles matched exactly at all 17 markers that we tested. And after it was all said and done and we proved this, the family sent me photos of Earl J. Maxwell. So photo A is Ezekiel Harper. He's the man whose skeletal remains we exhumed and did DNA testing on. And this was one of the only photos we have of Ezekiel Harper. Photo C is Earl J. Maxwell, the alleged son of Ezekiel Harper, around or about the same age as Ezekiel is in photo A. And photo B is also Earl Maxwell, but when he was much younger. And so I didn't have these photos when I first started the DNA testing on the case, but as you can see, there's a very strong resemblance, even though we proved it through DNA. Had I seen these photos of Earl J. Maxwell at the beginning, I probably would have placed some bets that he's definitely the son. Their nose is very similar. Their brow ridge, their eyes are very similar, their face shape, etc. But this was another historical case that we were able to solve with DNA. And by the way, I published a lot of that. It was a pretty extensive Y chromosome DNA project. If you want to read more about it, I published that as well, and here are the screenshots. If we had more time, I would go over a case that I worked in India and another skeletal remains case that I worked out of Deadwood, South Dakota, which is a skeletal remains that were discovered from the Black Hills Gold Rush in the American Wild West, but maybe that's for another time. But that is how basically, that's how good our modern DNA technology is. All you hear about, or a lot of what you hear about on TV, is how we use forensic DNA testing for current casework, murder cases, rape cases, etc. But this type of work really tests the limits of what our modern DNA technology can do. So we can retrieve the molecular signatures of people that lived hundreds of years ago, which is, in my opinion, quite cool.
Well, thank you very much, Professor Ambers. That was a fantastic walk through history, archaeology, DNA technology, and a lot more. So we have a question from Marty Coburn, which is, How does the Q haplotype show up in such disparate regions as the Americas and France?
So there's that. That's an interesting question. So that particular scenario, you don't usually see them that far spread apart. There's, let me share my screen again and I'll show you. There's some indications that genealogists have tried to figure that out as well. And again, I'm not a genealogist, but let me go back here. So this is some information, because I was wondering that as well, where they're trying to figure out how haplogroup Q shows up in Europe, in this small pocket or area of the Rhone Alps region in France. And they think it is, right here. They think it is traced back to the Hunnic Empire. Remember, the Goths from Sweden were vassals of the Huns. And so they think it, this particular Y haplogroup came from the Hunnites. And that's why you have that pocket there in the in France. But it's a mystery. And so, on this slide here, this is directly from Upedia. They're trying to figure out the mystery of why haplogroup Q is in the Basque region of France. And again, they think it's, remember Attila the Hun and that part of history? Again, that's not my, I'm not a genealogist myself, but there's a big debate and discussion in the genealogical community, as well as in the evolutionary biology community, as to why we have that pocket of haplogroup Q. And we think it came from, in France, we think it came from the Hunnic Empire.
There's another question. Can you comment on the height of the Native American on the label?
The height for individual one or for individual?
Individual one.
So, yeah, so remember I said that was one of the early observations that we made about individual one. He was 5'11" based on the anthropological assessment of the remains. And right off the bat, when the anthropologist took those measurements and predicted his height to be 5'11", that was sort of a red flag, because that is very tall for Europeans at that time period. And again, at the time we were not thinking that, we thought we had two European males in that shipwreck, but that should have been our early indicator that we were dealing with a non-European individual. And ultimately the DNA confirmed that.
So typically these cases have taken you at least 5 to 10 years to finally tie up all the loose ends. Is that because those remains are so ancient, and if you were maybe ancient is not the technically correct word, but old, for more recent remains, for example, the Maxwell, the Harper case, was that faster?
So skeletal remains do take a long time to process in the lab, and you have to have special facilities with negative airflow systems and UV overhead lights to sterilize your surfaces. So it's pretty time and labor intensive. I will tell you, like current modern cases, we could probably get done in a couple of months. A big part of the reason these cases took so long to complete is funding. So, in missing persons casework, which is what I started with, I wasn't doing historical and archaeological work to begin with, but in modern missing persons or unidentified skeletal remains cases, the Department of Justice, the federal government, pays for that work. So we have all the supplies that we need to do that work, so we can jump right in and start working on the remains. For historical and archaeological remains, they're non-probative, so obviously the Department of Justice doesn't fund that. So I ended up having to write research grants to get the funding, to get somebody to support the DNA testing of those remains. And as you can imagine, most historical societies and archaeological societies don't have a lot of money. So sometimes they can give you enough funding just to do the DNA extraction, and you get that done. And you basically do the DNA extraction as proof of concept, and you prove that you've recovered DNA, but you haven't profiled the DNA yet. Right. So then you have to put those DNA samples in the freezer and then go try to find someone that is willing to fund phase two of the project. So you're constantly trying to get enough funding from historical and archaeological groups to finish the testing. Had we had the funding to begin with, I think it was four or five years that I worked on the LaBelle shipwreck remains, I probably could have gotten that done within a year, both sets of remains. The other thing I'll say that takes a lot longer with historical and archaeological remains, remember how I showed you that we take multiple cuttings from the bone? So with fresher bones, with newer bones, often we just need one cutting to get a full profile. And with archaeological and historical remains, we often have to do 10, 20, sometimes 30 cuttings separately to get enough partial, because the DNA is so degraded, to get partial profiles to piece together the partial DNA profiles into a full profile. So you have to really use a lot more of the skeleton to find the intact DNA in older samples compared to modern cases.
Fascinating. Does anyone have any questions, or if you would like to, I think Professor Ambers said she's provided her contact information, right?
Yes.
I can also include it in my summary email that I will send out if, should you have any questions. But I love the fact that you've already offered to come back and talk to us. So that's fantastic. Thank you. Thank you very much again. And we'd love to have you come back. And just want to thank everyone for coming, especially Professor Ambers for coming and talking to us. And we couldn't have had a better talk to do that with brought so many different strands of information together. So happy holidays, everyone, and stay safe.